suspect that their inner content has nothing in common, and without the basic fact that owing to the progressively deteriorating conditions of ordinary life, particularly the wrong system of education of the rising generation, the various consequences of the properties of the organ come to buffer appear much more intensely in the common presence of people in recent times. I consider it necessary to say, and even to emphasize, that all misunderstandings arising in the process of our collective life, especially in our mutual relationships, all disagreements, disputes, settlings of accounts, and hasty decisions which after being carried out again, if the lingering processes, remorse of conscience, and even such great events as wars, civil wars, and other calamities are probably the result of the property of the common presence of ordinary people who have never specially worked on themselves, which I would call, reflecting reality upside down. Quote. Every man who can think even a little seriously, without being so discreet, identified with his passion, must agree with this if he takes into account only one simple fact often repeated in the process of our inner life, namely, that all our experiences that seem so dreadful while we are going through them appear to our logical reasoning to be not worth a red cent. After a lapse of only a short time, during which they have been replaced by other experiences and chance to be recalled when we are already in another mood. The results of this thinking and feeling often lead the average man to make, as it might be expressed, a fly out of an elephant and an elephant out of a fly. Of this harmful property in the common presence of people become particularly intense during such events as wars, revolutions, civil wars, and so on at such times of state, recognizable even by them, is most acutely manifested under the influence of these rare exceptions they all fall, and which they call mass psychosis. The chief characteristic of this stage is that when ordinary people which are already feeble mentation, which at such times become still feebler, receive shocks from the maleficent stories of some lunatic or other, they become in the full sense of the word victims of these malicious stories and manifest themselves completely automatically. While they are under the influence of this maleficent property, already permanently rooted in ordinary contemporary people, their secrets exist in their common presence that sacred something called conscience, whose acquisition was possible for them thanks to the values which they were endowed by great nature, as godlike beings in contrast to mere animals. People sincerely regret this property in our contemporaries because, according to historical data as well as the discoveries of many genuine human beings of past epochs, great nature no longer has any need for such a phenomenon as mass psychosis for maintaining her equilibrium. On the contrary, the periodic manifestation of this property in people compels her again and again to make new adaptations. For instance, increasing the birth rate, changing what is called the tempo of the general psyche, and so on and so forth. After everything I have said, I consider it necessary to emphasize further that all the historical data that have reached certain contemporary people and have also happened to become known to me concerning what really did occur in the life of people of former times, and not just those data invented by contemporary so-called scholars, chiefly the Germans, whose history has struck the brains of all the rising generation almost everywhere on Earth. of life, but then all flowed along in a single river. The general life of mankind has been divided into two streams only since the time of what is called the Kitchenician civilization, which immediately preceded the Babylonian civilization. From that time on, there was gradually established a present mode of existence of mankind which, as every sane thinking man must acknowledge, can flow more or less tolerably only if people are divided into masters and slaves. Although to be either masters or slaves is equally unworthy of many children of our common father, yet in existing conditions already thoroughly fixed in the process of the collective life of people, the origin of which lies in remote antiquity, we must be reconciled to this and accept a compromise, which according to impartial reasoning corresponds to our own personal welfare and at the same time is not contrary to the commandments specially wishing to us men from the prime source of everything existing. Quote. In my opinion, if certain people consciously undertake, as the chief aim of their existence, to acquire in their presence of all the corresponding data to become masters among those around them similar to themselves. Proceeding from this and acting according to the wise saying of ancient times, which affirms that, in order to be a just and good altruist one must first of all be an out-and-out egoist, each one of us, making use of the common sense given us by great nature, must set as his chief aim to become a master. But not a master in the sense that this word conveys to contemporary people, namely, one who has many slaves and much money, usually handed down by inheritance, but in the sense of a man who, thanks to his objectively virtuous acts toward those around him, that is, acts manifested according to the dictates of his pure reason alone, without the least participation of those impulses engendered in him as in all people by the consequences of the properties of that maleficent organ tumble upper, requires in himself that something which impels all those around him to bow before him and with reverence to carry out his orders. I now consider this first series of my writings concluded, and concluded in such a sense that it satisfies even myself. In any case, I give myself my word that from tomorrow I shall not spend even 5 more minutes of my time on this first series. And now, before setting to work on the second series of my writing, in order to give it a form accessible to everyone, I intend to rest for a whole month, to write absolutely nothing and, for a stimulus to my organism, which needs to the extreme limit, will leave a drink of still remaining 15 bottles of supermost super heavenly nectar, which at the present time is known on Earth as O-Calvados. This O-Calvados, by the way, 27 bottles of it, I was considered worthy to find by accident buried under a and finally shot the dog, several years ago when I was digging a pit for storing carrots for the winter in one of the cellars of my present chief dwelling place. The bodies of this divine ritual were buried in all probability by monks who had lived in this place, and were able to see the salvation of their that they buried these bottles there, and that, by virtue of what is called their intuitive perspicacity, the data for which, one must assume, were formed in them thanks to their pious knowledge, they foresaw that the The storyteller is a good one.